So yeah, so welcome everyone. I think I'm audible. I'm actually speaking from Kishore sir's mic, and I'm actually sharing my screen as well from my personal computer. We had some technical glitch starting from the morning. What happened is actually one of our laptop crashed, and because of that we were delayed in many things, because we lost our data in the morning. And then we had to restart from the scratch in the later morning until the session time was actually almost to start. So because of that technical glitch, please excuse us. Because of that also, we are actually having a little bit of a delay. So without actually now making any more delay, let me actually start with the topic. Okay. So welcome again. I'm actually the co-founder of DRNMDKS and ProN 4.0. And here at this place in Lyad Institute, Chamber of Commerce, Sangli, I also have some of my students who are actually presently working with me. I have some of my students who are actually also online. I've actually had a lot of students for the last many years. I have not invited everyone for this session because this was the first session we were trying to conduct. However, many of them are here already, and some of them are online, and many of them are not here. Apart from that, our anchor of today, Vaishnavi Guru, have introduced all our associates, as well as have introduced all the guests, chief guests and guest of honors. I would like to again thank to all of them for being present either in the online mode or in the offline mode. For example, Ms. Sneha Patil, madam, who's our chief, our guest of honor, has showed her presence in offline mode as well as in online mode. She's in the session in the place. One of our associate who is actually from UK, he is actually on a vacation in India, Mr. Yash Shah. So he's also there. He's with us right now. And then many of them are abroad, so they are actually able to log in from their side. So thank you so much. So let me start the session without any delay. So today's session is about how to enrich our CV by gearing up with education 4.0 to pursue higher studies at top level institutes and abroad in India. Now this topic is it's more or less to the students, right? So many of them here in this session might not be students. So that is one aspect. The other aspect is even if you're not a student, maybe you are actually already working somewhere still maybe you might want to actually enrich your CV. Because of the corona situation, because of the coronavirus pandemic, COVID-19 related things, the world has changed. We are actually moving from the conventional side of material physics to the digital side of the virtual side of non-material physics, and because of that there is a big transition. So it is a transition for everyone. It is just not a transition for students, but it is a transition for teachers, it is a transition for businessmen, it is a transition for presently who are working. And there is actually a term that is coined for the previous many times or many years, that 4.0, right? So what is 4.0? It is actually nothing but the fourth generation. So here our company, we are actually coming with the fourth generation kind of products and services. And that's why we are also calling our company as Pro in professional in 4.0. And it is all about 4.0, industry 4.0, agriculture 4.0, education 4.0. And we are in education. So we are calling it as education 4.0. Okay. So in my talk, I want to convince you that what is exactly 4.0 and how you can actually take it forward, and you can actually use it either by getting trained or by doing some hands-on or by actually kind of participating in some kind of internships that might be related to 4.0. So that will actually help you to enrich your CV, and you can actually end up in a better job eventually if you are looking for a job. Or I'm just going to try to show here, like, you know, how you can make your CV stronger. If in case you want to pursue, like, you know, higher studies, if someone is in grade 12, then they want to actually get into some, you know, a baccalaureate degree program. And if they are already, like, you know, in the baccalaureate degree program, then if they want to actually get into masters, and if they are already into masters, then how they want to get into PhD. Now, my point is, like, you know, if you want to do something, you actually try to get it in the top, you know, the best one. Like, you, there is no point of actually going in doing some kind of education somewhere. So can we focus on the best? Can we try to focus on the best? So I'm just going to try to show you, you know, what could be the steps there. So before that, I want to tell that, you know, I qualify. So before I'm actually presenting my talk, I want to show that I qualify, right? So I'm actually a postdoc. I have actually completed my postdoctoral studies. I'm a PhD, I'm a master's, I have a bachelor's, I have did my 12th and I've did my 10th, right? So I've did actually, I went through all these steps of education and I have attained my highest actually, like, you know, level of education. And I've seen actually, like, you know, what are the advantages and disadvantages of those. So, for example, like, you know, I'm showing my, you know, my 10th standard certificate. I'm showing you my 12th standard certificate. I'm showing you my Shivaji University baccalaureate degree certificate. I'm presenting here my master's degree, like, you know, master's degree, we call it a magistrate in applied sciences degree certificate. Then I did like kind of two PhDs. So I have a one PhD, one certificate, and I also have a PhD two certificate. Okay, so from qualification, I think I qualify to actually talk something about, like, you know, CVs, to talk something about, like, you know, how we can upgrade, how we can enrich things. I've also did a lot of diplomas. So I have a diploma in integrated sensor systems training program. Then I've did some certificates. I have, like, you know, a certificate in basic business school. I did some, you know, certificate in innovation and startup. I did some certification in IPR. I did some certification in teaching, and I have also achieved some certificates in patents and designs. I've also, you know, did some competitions. So I have dealt with robotics. I'm a researcher, so I actually do a lot of publications. So in terms of publications, I have a Google profile, Google Scholar profile. I also have a ResearchGate profile. And then I currently work in an institute, like, you know, I'm in academics. I've been actually working in academics and industry in both places, parallelly, equally. So right now I work at a local institute, which is Padma Bhushan Vasundhara Patil Institute of Technology in India, Sangli, Maharashtra. And then I, like, you know, I just do, like, you know, the same thing, like, you know, how you can enrich your CV. So using the digital marketing. So this is actually one sample I'm already presenting to you, right? So my first slide was about my degree certificates. My second slide was, like, you know, about my diplomas and certificates. And the third slide is, like, you know, about, it is basically depicting what I've did throughout. So I'm actually trying to flaunt it. I'm actually using the digital media to illustrate it and to display it, right? So you have to do that. So this is the first step, like, you know, you need to show something in your CV. And number one is, like, you know, I had something to, now you need to know, like, you know, you have to show something, and then to show something, you have to do something, right? If you don't do it, then you might not be able to show it. So I have actually a lot of videos, hands-on videos, like, you know, these things are done with my students. Then I've also been interviewed in a local radio station. I've also, like, you know, had a lot of actually coverage in news articles. And then I actually have my own article that actually I published in a local newspaper. So all of these are what? These are actually related to education 4.0, because, you know, I'm using the digital technology. I'm using, like, you know, the online technology to kind of illustrate or to depict, you know, my work. So this is something, like, you know, you can start doing right now. I'm going into Marathi. I forgot, actually, we are, like, globally right now. So what you want to show in your CV, you need to actually, like, you know, you need to digitize that. So that is the first step. Any document that you have, you scan it and you keep it in your record and you keep it in your database, you keep it in your archives, or you actually upload it to the drive and you keep it with you. The digital version of your work achievement certificate, anything that you have to show, you have a digital version, good, number one, that you can put in your CV, okay? So number next I want to show you is, so education in India, right? So if you go to education in India, or even if you go to education abroad, doesn't matter, it's more or less the same, even if the national education policy or the new education policy that has been actually implemented in India, there is not much difference in what I want to show you here. So number one, when you are a kid, when we were a kid, when we all were a kid, we probably went to nursery. Some nurseries are also called as, in Maharashtra, there are actually like some places where you send your kids, like play schools. There are also some governments, government run. So all of those are nurseries, right? So there is actually nursery, preschooling, nursery, junior KG, senior KG, all that, I call it nursery, okay? We can bifurcate it into more, but let's call it nursery. Then after that, you have to go primary. Then you actually have to do secondary, right? So primary and secondary education, we all know that. And then from the secondary, there is actually a way that you can do, you can actually get a certificate, diploma or trade. You can go that way. Or some people choose to actually join higher secondary, which is actually 11th and 12th. After 11th and 12th, again, you have a option, you can go to do bachelor's, or you can again go for diploma, you can do a trade, or you can do a certificate. Bachelor's, you did your bachelor's, it could be any bachelor's, it could be in any branch, BCom, arts, engineering, masters, biology field. After that, what you're going to do, you're going to do your postgraduate. So postgraduate, after bachelor's, you want to do a postgraduate, now you want to get into some good institute, good university. You want to university in India or probably somewhere else in the world. So, like, you know, how that? Actually achieve that. Then after that, let's say you want to. I don't know, like, this is not mandatory, right? It can be different for different people. Then after doctorate, there is also another education platform, which is called as postdoctorate. So you can actually go for that. Some people do double masters, some people do triple masters, some people do double PhDs, some people do a lot of certificate diplomas, maybe some people do trades, right? Some people, so everyone has an opportunity, everyone has a chance, and everyone will do something according to what they actually know, or what they are educated by someone, or if they have a mentor, they will actually follow their mentor, right? So apart from this education system that we see in general, I'll show you a very interesting slide. And that is actually, like, you know, that is very important. This I'm just going to show you in dollars, okay, American dollars, because American dollars is the strongest currency as of now in the world, even at least now. And then you can actually relate it to the Indian rupees, okay? So here in this slide, what it shows is, it actually has like two bar graphs. The first, the one in blue, is actually showing the unemployment rate, and the one in the green is showing the the salary of the employed people, like, you know, in terms of median, like, you know, the statistical median, right? It's not the mean, but it is the median, right? So if you look from bottom to the top, so the bottom ones, diploma, if someone did, like, you know, high school and then diploma, then they might actually end up in the 5.4% like unemployment rate segment. If they actually do a high school diploma, right, less than high school diploma is something below 10th grade. High school diploma is like after the 10th grade. Some college or no degree means they did some college, but they actually quit it, like, you know, they didn't complete. So from that 5.44 to 3.7 to 3.2, and someone, if they actually have a professional degree is like something like, you know, bachelor's, becoming a doctor, becoming a pharmacist, or probably even doing something like, you know, in the line of medicine. It could be like, you know, radio technician, or it could be like, you know, something like, you know, therapy technician, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, and all those. So those people, like, you know, so if you look at the salaries now, so the minimum will be like, you know, the one who does a high school diploma, and then the maximum salaries will be driven by the professional degrees and the doctoral degrees. So people who actually do the professional or the doctoral degrees, definitely they will be earning like, you know, more compared to anyone. Okay, so this is actually the value of education. So people who are actually going to school from nursery till actually post doctorate, so they need to know, like, you know, why they are doing it and like, you know, where they want to end up in terms of their earnings, right? So these are all the steps, and depending on what step you're going to take, you are actually going to get the outcome in terms of salaries, or going to get the outcome in terms of being employed or being non-employed, right? So the next one is, like, you know, the learning, like, you know, in education 4, which is actually objective based learning. So what they are actually trying to make everyone understand that, so there are levels of education, right? So if someone cannot actually just create something, so before he creates something, there are some steps. So the initial step is remembering. At least every one of us, they have to remember. After that, we have to understand what we are remembering. Means you just remember, for example, all of us actually probably, like, you know, it's not a good thing to say here, but let's say I remember something in Kannada, I speak Marathi. Or let's say I learn something, I remember something in German language, and I speak English, but I don't understand it. I'll just say, like, you know, bonjour, kamasawa. What does it mean? I don't know. So there is no point of remembering, right? You have to remember something, but you have to understand that. So after understanding, there is no use of just understanding. You have to apply that. After applying, there is no point of applying. You have to analyze that if it is right or wrong. If you are actually analyzing it, then you have to evaluate it, that if it is actually the best way or if it is the not the best way. And after that, then you can create something. So you have to go through all these levels. So education is not just, you know, because it is object oriented, manje, you have to know your goal. You know, what is your goal? Your goal is to create something. Okay, so you want to create something, then you have to remember first, you have to understand it, you have to apply it, you have to analyze it, you have to evaluate, and you have to create. Because all of us who are going to go for a job eventually, even if you start a company, you become a CEO, or you actually become a director, or you actually, like, you know, you are actually working in some company, you become a manager, you become a CEO, you become actually a MD, or you are just, like, you know, a normal team member, right? So you are there to create something. And what we want to create, maybe everyone wants to create wealth, everyone wants to create, like, you know, something that is useful by the company, that can be used by the humans and all living organisms on this planet. So you want to create something. So to create something, you have to go through this step, and this is actually about education 4.0, right? So among that, like, you know, so I want to actually, like, you know, go to the next slide is, so when we are learning something, we will actually be acquiring a lot of skills. So there are two types of skills. Can you hear me? Am I audible? Okay, so the slides for some reason is not changing. Just give me a moment. Yeah. Arvind sir, are you there? Yeah, hi. Actually what I'm doing is I'm connecting to another computer, and my slides are in some other computer, so that's actually the problem. Let me now jump to Kishore sir's actually computer, and let me see if I can, but I'm not able to do the screen sharing from this side. So let me, yeah, just give me a moment, okay? Now it shifted. Okay, great. I was mentioning, so when we go to school and when we actually want to actually use what we did in the school, it all depends on the skills. So when we are going to do something, we are going to acquire hard skills and we are going to acquire soft skills. And both of these skills are going to be used to create something. While creating, there will be analysis, there will be evaluation, and then there will be creation. Okay, so that is for sure. And every people's role might be different. Can you hear me? Sorry, actually my screen actually got disconnected. So let me just come back again. Oh, okay. Yes, I did that, but it doesn't transit. Yeah, I did that. I did that, and it doesn't actually go in that. No, it doesn't. For some reason, no. Actually, excuse us for a moment. So, in terms of hard skills, let me actually continue with my talk. So, we are going to have a record. We are actually recording this session, so we'll be able to send you the recording again to everyone. So, so please excuse us for now. So, in terms of hard skills, like, you know, so someone might actually have a proficiency in foreign language. Okay, now foreign language for us, now you cannot hear it. Now no one can hear me. Hello. No, yeah, I'm audible actually. Yeah. So proficiency in English in a foreign language, right? So maybe Hindi, Sanskrit might be also a foreign language for actually the foreigners. So for us actually, if we know Sanskrit and Hindi, and or if someone wants to come from another country into India, then it can be a foreign language. So foreign language can be a relative term, and for us, because we are in India and we are actually, like, you know, having our mother tongue, so foreign language might be different. But if you are actually proficient in it, and currently, like, you know, there are actually languages which are very demanding, and out of that actually Chinese is actually the most demanded language. So if someone is actually going to learn Chinese, and if they can become proficient in Chinese, they can do a lot of things in their life. So that is actually because China is the second GDP country in the world, right? So the first is the US and the second is the China. So a degree certificate, did I get, like, you know, 10th degree, 12th degree, a baccalaureate degree, master's degree, PhD, postdoctorate. So all these degrees, these are all hard, like, you know, hard skills. If I am able to type something, if I can do operate a machine, if I can do programming language. So all what we are actually going to learn in the school, and probably if we are going to go on intern to some industry. So what we are going to learn there, when we have to do something physically, when we have to create something, or we have to analyze something, or if you have to evaluate something. So all those will be termed as the hard skills. So what are the soft skills? So soft skills are, like, you know, how can we communicate? How do we communicate? Like, you know, I'm proficient in this language, but I don't speak to anyone. I don't know how to speak to anyone, or I feel scared when I see someone. I don't know. So there is no point, right? So you need to also develop your soft skills. So communication skills are very important. We have to be flexible. We have to actually have a leadership skill. We should be able to work in team. Like, you know, someone is very good at doing things super, but when they actually do a work in a team, it doesn't work properly. So you need to be able to work as a team. Am I audible to everyone? Hello? Some people are saying I'm not audible. Yeah, I'm audible. Yeah, okay. Yes. So then the last one is team management, time management. So if I'm really good in things, and if I cannot manage my time, means I will, someone tells me some work to analyze, evaluate, or create, and then they tell me, like, you know, the deliverable is in like 24 hours from today. You can work in you can work two 8-hour shifts and take a 8-hour break. So in 16 hours, if you can finish your job, that can be great. But I'm not able to do it. It will take me 1 month. Right, I can do it in what, 16 hours, but I can only work 1 hour a day, and then I will take 16 days to finish it. So that is not going to help. So that is the soft skill. Okay, so we have to work. We have to work on that. And then also important is, like, you know, there are three types of skills. So let's say if you are actually doing some kind of a job, like, for example, right now I have a job, and I'm actually an operator probably, like, on a telephone exchange. So some calls actually come in, and then I have to actually, like, you know, press the codes, and then I have to divert them to the specific people, and in front I have actually some kind of a plan, some screen, and I look at it, and then I just divert it based on the codes. So this is, like, you know, some job specific skill. But, you know, there could be some skill which are transferable. Means before I used to work as an operator, but I was operating some machine. And that machine had a lot of inputs, like, you know, I had to turn some wheel, I had to press some buttons, I have to actually use my feet to push some lever. And so then now I'm actually working in a telephone exchange. So I'm still an operator. So the transferable skills are, like, you know, using that button, like, you know, probably using that screen, which actually will tell, or it has the labels about where to press, what to press, how to press. So similarly, like, you know, that is a transferable skill. I actually did an operator job, and now I'm actually again an operator, but, you know, I'm operating two different things. So that can be a transferable skill. It means that if you're operating a machine, if you have experience operating a machine, then you can also use that to operate some kind of a telephone exchange equipment. And probably if you want to become a cashier, so a cashier is, like, you know, using the teller machine and to punch the codes and, like, you know, to tell the prices and to take the money from the customers and then actually to return back the remaining portion of, you know, the price. So these are all, like, you know, similar jobs. So the transferable skills, you have to understand what are your transferable skills and how you can use it to the job that you are actually going to work in the specific. But then there are some actually skills which you have to acquire. Means you're doing some job and this is actually a telephone operator job. And I did a machine operator job before, but the telephone operator job is different. Like, you know, I don't need to use my legs. I don't need to move a lot. I just have to sit on a chair and I have to actually work with it. So adaptable skills, like, can I actually sit in the chair for a long time? Am I adaptable enough to sit in the chair for a long time? Even if I did an experience of operating some machine and I want to actually now operate some equipment by just sitting in one place. So these are the skills, and you have to realize, you have to remember, you have to understand that, you know, what skills you have in your past, what skills are necessary for your current job, and what skills are that you don't have right now and you want to acquire. Okay, so these are the important things. Now let me go to the next slide. So once you are in school, probably you actually did some internship or you're already working. Now you actually want to create a CV because you want to move on to another company or you want to go for higher education. So what you have to put in your CV? CV or the resume is something important. So decision making. You have to illustrate, like, you know, if you made any decisions, right? By analyzing, by evaluating things. So if you have an experience of decision making, you put it in your CV, because these are the very important, actually, like, you know, details related to your profession. Leadership, if you actually have an experience of leading a team of people, like, you know, it could be, like, you know, even if you actually lead a team of people, as a sports member, you were a captain of some sports, but still you were a leader, you have a leadership skill, so put it in your CV. Problem solving, if there was a lot of problems and, you know, in that actually work, you were able to solve a problem. Now, solving a problem can be, like, you know, solving a machine problem, solving a programming problem, solving human problems. So any problem you saw, you solved, you actually experienced it, you put it in your CV. You did teamwork, you actually worked with someone without any conflict, you actually had to, deal with all people, and you still were able to actually complete your task or analyze or evaluate things, you actually put it in your CV. Are you active listening? Are you good in communication? Are you good in critical? So all of these are demonstrable skills. You have to put it in your CV if you have it. Okay? Now, I think we are in short in time, so I just want to go fast as possible. So now I want to focus on, like, you know, because my today's topic is not more related to someone who wants to pursue higher education. Now, in India or as well as in abroad, okay? Now, why we are actually talking about this? Because one of our companies actually, product is, like, you know, to help students who want to pursue higher education in Canada, and also to help students or even, like, current employees of different companies if they want to actually move to Canada based on skill, if they want to immigrate there, right? So those are the two actually, like, you know, products and services that we have in our company. And that's why I want to actually show something about this and talk something specific. I'm starting here for a simplicity that someone has a bachelor degree. Now here what I'm trying to show, if someone wants to get admitted in a top institute in XYZ country, let's say, like, you know, in Canada, for example. Now you first need to know what are the top institutes, okay? That I will be anyways telling you again later, but there are actually rankings for institutes, and usually each countries have, like, you know, first class institutes, second class institutes, and third class institutes. Okay, so tier 1, tier 2, and tier 3. So top ones are, like, you know, in the tier 1, right? So the best ones. Now what they need? So what they need is, like, you know, you need to have a bachelor's degree. Let's say you want to get into master's program. You need to have a bachelor's degree. Then you need to have good grades. Okay, good grades are actually relative terms, but you need to have good grades. We can actually speak about that eventually. Then the institute where you're doing your bachelorate degree should be accredited institute. Like, there are actually NBA, there is NAC, there is ISO, there is actually a lot of accreditations. So out of that, NBA is the best one. If any institute has an NBA accreditation, and if they are actually, like, you know, if the program is accredited, then very good, nice. Okay, so bachelor degree, good grades, accredited, okay, good. This is a conventional way. Then you need to appear for a English or a other foreign language. Let's say you want to go to France, you need to actually appear for the French language. You want to go to Germany, you need to appear for the German language. Okay, so you need to actually appear for it, and you have to have a good score in it. Then you have to also appear for CET, SAT, GATE, GMAT, GRE, many options if you want to do MBA, or if you want to actually do different programs. So that you have to also have the scores. Okay, so after that, you should also be prepared for qualitative and quantitative aptitude tests. You should be also doing a lot of group interviews, like, you know, interview, group discussion sessions, and all those things. So that you need to have experience. So in your college, in your school, if you can get involved in these, that is going to help you to reach to the top level in terms of institutes. Then you have to actually start making your cover letter. You have to actually start your making your statement of purpose. You have to actually create good reference letters. You have to be good with your supervisors or the people with whom you worked, because they are going to give you the good references. So you have to actually maintain your relationships, right? Like, you know, in a good manner, you have to actually be working good. Relationship is not like buttering, but you have to actually demonstrate what you're going to put in your CV, and you're going to have some mentor, so that will be your reference, right? So all these are very important. So this is a conventional way, like, you know, this is something not 4.0. This is like third generation, second generation. Now what I want to show you here is, so what is the fourth generation? So now if you can really, like, you know, add skills to you, so if you can actually have good publication, if you can actually have patents, so patent is another segment, like, you know, our actually company is actually having, and we are partnering with IPFied. Their associates are here already. They are our channel partners, and they are also going to have their next talk. So you need to actually have, like, you know, publications. If you can do patents, if you can go on international internship, so that also we have, that actually kind of option we have it with us. Then hands-on volunteering works, attending conferences, like, you know, doing workshops, conducting webinars, participating in webinars. So all of these, if you can do that, that is actually kind of under 4.0. But you have to remember that objective, like, you know, what is your objective? Why you want to do that? Do it without objective. You actually have to have an objective. Okay, so remember that. So that is actually 4.0. 4.0 is something objective oriented. You're doing something because you have an objective. Manje, in Marathi, there is actually a story. I think in all languages they might have it. So there used to be a legendary Arjun, who is actually, like, you know, legendary archer. He actually had a guru. Guru is actually, like, you know, he was a disciple of the best teacher, which was actually Dronacharya. And Dronacharya used to ask, when you are actually pulling your arrow, and what do you see in your target? So the target should be the bullseye. Means there used to be a parrot, and the parrot actually had an eye, and inside the eye there is a pupil. So does he see the pupil? So if he can see the pupil, then he will be the best pupil, or he will be the best disciple of Dronacharya. So Arjuna was the only one who could see the bird's pupil, and he could actually send his arrow exactly. It will actually hit the target. That's the bullseye, right? So objective, something like that. So when you're going to do something, you need to have an objective. Without objective, doing something is actually useless. It is waste of time. So that is something 4.0. That is what I'm trying to tell you. Now, once you have all this bachelor degree, good grades, accredited from an accredited institute, score in foreign language, score in like, you know, your quantitative, aptitude test, you have a good reference, cover letters, all. And then if you have all these additive skills that you can demonstrate, illustrate and put in your CV, then you will have a good CV. And then you can start actually applying for positions. You can also end up probably going into MIT, which is Massachusetts Institute of Technology in the US. That is the number one institute in the world in terms of technical education. You might want to actually get into Stanford. You might want to get into Oxford, like from UK, something from UK. There is actually another Oxford Brookes actually University, and we have one of our associate who actually was there in UK. So Mr. Yasha. Or you want to go to Germany, like, you know, there are many top level institutes in Germany, or you want to end up in India. In India, we have actually, like, you know, many high ranking institutes now in the technical actually field, like, you know, the IITs, IIT Delhi, IIT Bombay, IIT Chennai, IIT actually Kharagpur. So all of these are actually having good rankings. They are probably under 50 now. Go to McGill, I'm from McGill. McGill University used to be, like, you know, under 25 global ranking, and they actually have many Nobel laureates. Nobel Prize winners are actually, like, you know, one of the best people in the world. So there are 12 people who actually won Nobel Prizes from McGill. So I'm actually from McGill. I'm a McGill alumni from Canada. So all of that will come with this if you have some good plan and if you actually have a good objective. Okay, so that is very important. Now, next is, like, you know, so what can you actually do, like, you know, when I'm saying 4.0 objective, how can you add your CV with patent publication, right? Or if you want to go, you want to do some training related to 4.0 technologies. So you can learn robotics, you can learn actually Arduino, Raspberry Pi, IoT, CAD means like, you know, computer aided design. You can actually learn about 3D printing. You can learn C, Python programming, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning. You have to be able to do data analytics. You should do mobility analytics using GIS. You should publish on all these, actually in all these areas, like in a research paper, or you should be doing some projects, and then you should file an IPR. Okay, so all of these services that will add or enrich your CV is provided by actually ProN 4.0 and DRNMDKS ICPL, okay, from Sangli. And we actually are third partnering with actually many other associates from the world, and also from top level company IP5 right now, and they will actually demonstrate you how to actually go ahead with that as well. So that all of that is going to help you to enrich your CV, and you will be ending up into probably one of the top level institutes in the world, right? So our company, what they do, like, you know, we do virtual R&D, means if you want to file a patent, we will file a patent for you, guaranteed. Okay, we can also help for copyright. There is a lot of digital data that we are creating, right? Your CV could be also something, like, you know, unique, you know, how you are actually portraying your own personal information. So that can be copyrighted, because it's a document. If someone from your side wants to do, like, you know, a company, maybe they designed something, maybe they have some words, some actually, like, you know, quotes, they can be trademarked or copyrighted again. We can also file for utility patents. We can do a lot of industrial designs. We can set up, like, you know, this innovation cell schools in the schools, where we can provide all these services. We can help you to make your digital CV. Now, example of a digital CV is myself. Actually, I have a personal website, and a personal website, I actually have all my information on my website. So if I want to share details about myself, I just click the link. I just copy the link of my website and send it to someone who wants to watch it, and they will go through it in their phone. So that is actually a digital CV. I have my digital portfolio. All of you can also make it. And digital marketing, right? So digital marketing is very important. Like, you know, what you have put in your CV, like, you know, what enrichment you have given into your CV, unless and until you don't send it or share it with anyone, no one is going to know about you, and then it will not have any outcome, right? So you want to do marketing, like, you know, about your own CV, about your own brand. So all that is actually coming. This is all 4.0. Okay, so that is all what we have in our company, in our organization, and we focus more on foreign education services with special education attention to Canada. So if someone wants to go to Canada, end up in a top level institute in any program, here I don't want to focus on only engineering. If you want to do something in arts, commerce, political science, humanities, environment, agriculture, you can go into or designing, you know, architecture, you want to go in any program, we can help you for that, and we can help you to go in the top level institute, and we can provide all the different services so that with that medium you can actually end up there. And so for example, if possible, I would like to show some demonstrations, but I think we are short of time. So we'll be sending you the links, you know. So we actually, what we have is, like, you know, we have this additive skill training, so we can teach everyone about Arduino. We have a big team. I have a lot of students working on it in terms of internships. You can work with Raspberry Pi. You can work with actually Lego robot, which is one of the advanced robot. You can learn Python programming. You can learn C programming. You can actually learn 3D printing and all that, right? So all those services we have. If you want to have a good CV, if you actually want to do a paper, if you want to do a publication, if you want to do IPR, so all that we have here, okay? So I think so that's all for the session from my side. And I think I will have to invite our partner from IPFI, because they have their session. They want to talk about virtual R&D or IPR in general, right? So let me, so thank you so much everyone for attending this session. For thank you here. Thank you so much to actually the audience who's sitting in front of me as well in person. Thank you so much for coming here, and thank you for some of the Sneha Madam, for example. She's one of my colleague, and she's here in person. So I thank her. I thank Yash Shah for being here. I thank all. I thank actually our companies, my partner, my co-founder.